वहां तो हिमालय नहीं है बट ज्वाइंट आईआईटी खड़गपुर, पहले वो डेजर्ट वाला आदमी खड़गपुर में आ गया, खड़गपुर से फिर जमशेदपुर ज्वाइन किया टाटा स्टील एंड टाटा स्टील में ज्वाइंट एज अ जीटी एंड देन गॉट द माउंटेनियरिंग बग, गॉट पैशनेट अबाउट माउंटेनियरिंग एंड इन फैक्ट इन हिज फर्स्ट अटेम्प्ट एट एवरेस्ट दैट टाइम नेपाल में जो उछाल आ गया था दैट टाइम ही हैड हिज फर्स्ट अटेम्प्ट एंड देन लास्ट ईयर ही डिड हिज सेकंड अटेम्प्ट ऑफ लीडिंग अ ग्रुप एंड he is again one of those people who has climbed Everest at a very young age. So he is an Everester, so let's have a big round of applause for him for that. But it's not just about climbing the mountains for yourself, it's also about climbing, helping others climb mountains. So as the head of Tata Steel Adventure Foundation, number two, Pajendri Pal is number one at this point of time. She is the one who is the chief patron. He is further worked on promoting adventure within companies. You have attended some TSAF courses. Promoting the, what we call outbound learning. A lot of things about we discover about ourselves through outbound learning. And for that, we requested him to come over here and share his insights with you. Right? So next 1 hour, we are going to be with him. So we'll take a 2 minutes to know here. We'll just take a 2 minutes transition while we set up the things. And then I'll hand over to Hemant. And I'll introduce him once again and then maybe we can get started. Because we will be streaming that session live to people outside also. We have invited other people. Tumhare pehle wale batch mein, I could not get in there that time. So, you missed it, we'll stream it for you. So a very good evening to all of you and a very good evening to all those viewers who are also watching us on the YouTube live stream. This is again an experiment that we are starting in terms of new initiatives that we are taking for extending the reach of MTA and learning and development through digital initiatives. What we are trying to do is that whenever we get a speaker of repute or a speaker who has an interesting perspective or a point of view to share, we will try to beam their interactions live on YouTube so that you can watch them at your own time, at your own place, on your device of choice through YouTube. We have sent the links to this channel to people in all the plants and units, and I'm sure quite a few of you must be viewing it right now. Like all good things and all new things, we have hit a small technical snag. We will just be reconnecting the busy presentation that Hemant has to make. So while he is setting that up, let me just inform all the viewers about what we are going to discuss now and the context within which we are discussing having this interaction. This is part of a program on leadership for young managers, where we have brought in 25 of our bright young managers from different plants and units to get fresh perspectives on leadership and appreciate it not only from the nuances of how to deal with leadership in an industrial context, but understand it from the perspective of those contexts where you don't have a formal hierarchy. It is basically emergent leadership that comes in to play. In that given situation, somebody has to take on the role and steer the group to achievements which they normally on their own would not do. And such a situation can also happen in extreme sports. And one of them is high altitude mountaineering, which involves both determination, strength, as well as technical capabilities. I mean, beyond a certain stage, you don't climb just purely by enthusiasm. You need skills, you need techniques. And the speaker we have invited today for this interaction is Hemant Gupta. Again, giving a brief profile of the speaker. Hemant is a boy from Rajasthan, so that makes for a very fascinating story. Who did his BE metallurgy from IIT Kharagpur and then joined Tata Steel as a GED. So somebody who's grown up in life pursuing hardcore academics and academic excellence. Not really into too many sports here and there, and was a very thin, underweight, wiry kind of boy. Your stereotype of the padaku. And then in Tata Steel, he got introduced to mountaineering because as part of their induction, they also get to do some outbound learning under TSAF, which is being chaired by Ms. Pachandri Pal, who is a legend in India in terms of not only being a sports person, but also in terms of the kind of things that she has done for women empowerment and leading a lot of women team to Everest and promoting sports in this company. And then Hemant actually started learning the art of mountaineering, got some specialized training in Himalayan Institute of Mountaineering, was sent to US for National Outbound Learning School, where they teach you not only about mountaineering, but also about leading in the outbound, leading in those situations where there is no structure, there is no hierarchy, and you are actually in the unknown, because nature is nobody's property. Nature has its own rules, and those rules are applicable to everyone. So it doesn't distinguish between people. And that learning he is putting to use, not only in terms of the different expeditions that he has covered. He has been to a lot of places. Climbed Mount Everest in 2016. He made his first attempt and had to come back because of the earthquake in Nepal, and that itself was a very interesting experience because they'd actually reached base camp and then from there they had to come back, and being in Nepal at that point of time itself was a very scary and traumatic experience. But despite that, a lot of people kind of would give up, but what he did was he again made an attempt, and last year 2017 in April, he was along with the team, he was able to make the summit. So that is about his personal journey. But more than the personal journey, it's also a journey of how a leader grows to develop more leaders. So under the mentorship of Bachendri Pal. He is being groomed to take over the reins at Tata Steel Adventure Foundation, where they are working on helping a lot of not just students but also corporates take lessons in team building, leadership, communication, basic people skills, by taking them back to nature, putting them in situations where their old knowledge and, you know, stereotypes and heuristics do not work, and their core nature will come to the surface and they'll figure out what is it that they need to work on. So that's how they run those outbound training programs. And we have also at SAIL started outbound learning as a leadership development initiative, where we have sent some people, selected people to Uttarkashi on treks, not just to climb the mountains and conquer the mountains, but to conquer themselves and find out about themselves. So he's not only taken the journey himself about discovering himself, but also taken the journey of helping other people discover themselves. I'm sure you'll have a very fascinating story. So what we'll do is, I'll request Hemant to join us, and he can share his story. I think his presentation is set up now. Let's have a big round of applause for Hemant. What I'll do is, I'll request him to first share his journey of his life, of how he has grown over a bit of time and his leadership journey. And then we can have some questions and answers related to leadership that we can ask him, and he can respond. That's
thank you, sir. Good evening, everyone. So, as Sanjay sir has given a lot of introduction, so my apology because I think there was some problem in the laptop. So, I will first share my journey, like. Why the people go to the mountain and what they learn from it. And in the end, there would be, if you have any questions that you want to ask, so we'll try to wrap it up in like maybe in 15 minutes to 1 hour session. So my name is Hemant Gupta, and I was born and brought up in Kota, Rajasthan. And as you all know, that Kota is like hub for the like engineering and medical coaching. So I did coaching for IIT JEE from Kota, and I got through. And I was in IIT Bombay, and I did my B.Tech in Metallurgical Engineering from IIT Bombay, and I passed out in 2011. After graduating, I joined Tata Steel as a management trainee technical, MTT 2011 batch. And I was in Kalika Nagar project looking after desulfurizing unit. And when I was in college, I was always interested about traveling and going into the, and used to play a lot of sports. I was not good in any of the sports, but I used to play a lot of sports. So I was always passionate about it. And after my second year, I went to did my basic mountaineering course from Atal Bihari Vajpayee Institute in Manali. So there are three mountaineering institutes in India, Manali, Uttarkashi and Darjeeling. So I did a 1 month basic mountaineering course. It's a rigorous course where you learn the art of rock climbing, snowcraft and ice craft. And when I did basic mountaineering course, I never thought I will be doing a mountaineering as a profession, because normally after IIT you get placements in the coal companies or in the investment banking or consulting. So I got placement in Tata Steel, and when I joined Tata Steel, I got to know about Tata Steel Adventure Foundation. So TSAF is headed by Miss Bachendri Pal. I think aap sabhi logon ne suna hoga, unka Bachendri ma'am ka ji ke books mein हमेशा से बचपन में पढ़ते थे. तो शी इज द फर्स्ट इंडियन वुमन टू क्लाइंब एवरेस्ट एंड शी इज द हेड ऑफ टीएसएएफ. सो आफ्टर आई जॉइन टाटा स्टील, सो ड्यूरिंग पार्ट ऑफ आर ट्रेनिंग, वन ईयर ट्रेनिंग जो होता है इन टाटा स्टील, वी हैड टू अंडरगो आवर 10 डेज प्रोग्राम इन उत्तरकाशी. इट्स पार्ट ऑफ ट्रेनिंग ओनली, आउटबाउंड ट्रेनिंग, एंड देयर आई गॉट टू नो अबाउट टीएसएएफ. एंड आफ्टर दैट आई वेंट टू वन एक्सपीडिशन लेह लद्दाख. इट वॉज लाइक जमशेर गांधी एक्सपीडिशन एंड दैट वॉज माई फर्स्ट मेजर आई वुड से एक्सपीडिशन. आई वेंट टू द पीक एंड so we were not able to climb the summit, and after I came back there were two options. I get I usse demotivate ho jata and bol deta ki like mountaineering not my cup of tea, or I get the learnings why I failed. And in that expedition I realized like what were the things which I have to improve if I have to succeed in the future. So after that expedition I came back and I like, also to succeed in mountaineering you have to build your fitness, and it's also physical fitness and mental fitness. And in physical fitness you have to build your endurance, your stamina and your strength also, because it's a combination of, because when you are at high altitude your strength should be there. So cardio, like endurance, like you can run long distances, and you should have a good strength. So like strength you can develop by climbing rocks or do some 1 or 2 days workout in a gym. So after that expedition I came back and I started to work on my fitness so I can again go back to the mountains. So that expedition was in 2012, and in this expedition I met Bachindri ma'am personally, and in this expedition she used to share her journey in Tata Steel and TSAF, what TSAF is doing. So basically TSAF is an institute where we build leadership and team building through medium of adventure, through medium of outdoors. So we take people to the outdoors, we put them into the challenging situation in the limited resources, in the constraint, and then you have to perform, and then the teams have to perform, and then the whole learning comes into the picture. So it's a non-conventional classroom, I would say. Nature is a non-conventional classroom. So after that expedition I came back. So I was still in Kalinganagar plant. So I was based in Kalinganagar plant. I was looking, as I said, I was looking after diesel for engineering. And then I again went back to a, there is an island peak in Nepal. It's a 600 meter peak. Have you heard of Arunima Sinha? Arunima Sinha is the first female amputee in the world to climb Mount Everest. So she was also trained by Tata Steel only, trained and supported by Tata Steel. So with her I went to went till Everest base camp and climbed and was attempting Island Peak. And it was in March 2013, and it was my first successful expedition. So like in August 2012 I failed, September 2012. In 6 months, I did training for 6 months, and I again back, again back to the mountaineering, and so that was my first success into the field of mountaineering, I would say. And after that expedition, there were always life mein kahi bata na ki there is some calling from your inside, like you want to do this in future. So I was thinking what I want to do now, and I was thinking what are the different options, because I was more passionate about mountaineering and outdoor. So I thought Tata Steel Adventure Foundation can be a good platform for me. So I approached Bachindri ma'am and then our senior management and told them like if I want to join TSA, what I can contribute. And in September 2013, I took a transfer from plant to Tata Steel Adventure Foundation. So these are the so on the left is the Jamshed Gangi expedition. That was the failure. On the right is my first peak, Island Peak, which I climbed in March 2013. So after I joined TSAF, I went to 3 months. I completed my diploma in outdoor education from National Outdoor Leadership School. And if you if you search about National Outdoor Leadership School, they do training for lots of corporates. They do for US Navy, NASA, astronauts. And their like philosophy is they take you into the extreme situation and they test how you are performing as a leader, how you are working in a team. And so there would be very less resources and you have to perform. There will be a constraint. So it was basically a three months program where we had 5 different sections. First section was wilderness first responder. Like basically if I'm guiding or leading a team into the mountains, and if something bad happens, then how we can provide immediate first aid to the patient or the person. So that was the first certification. Then second was it was a winter section, and we had to survive temperatures like minus 27 degrees, minus 30 degrees in the night. These were the temperatures, and there were no tents, we made our own snow shelters and lived there. So it was 15-day session, and like the rucksack, and so we had to carry everything by ourselves. So it's like a basically a team of 10 people with two instructors. Instructors are there to provide the safety, but we have to manage everything by ourselves in a team of 10. So we have to carry like food, ration, then fuel, then all the equipment required for survival, tent, sleeping bag. So everything we have to carry on either on our back or on our sledge. Sledge, dekha hoga na, log jo pull karte hain. Like Arctic वगैरह में तो the second section was winter section and then third section was canoeing is like so we were dropped at the river पे एक जगह पर छोड़ दिया था and we had to traverse 160 kilometers in the river and so every day we used to canoe for like 15-20 kilometers then camp on the side of the river then next day again move on each day apart from like climbing or canoeing or mountaineering there would be some activities which are focused on leadership and team building. And every day there in the evening, there used to be in the evening, like how the day went, what was the strength of the leader. Like if I am leading the group, the peer used to review me, how I led the team, what could have been done better. So that's how every day leader was assessed by the team and by the self also. So these are the certifications which I got. And these are some of the, so like on the left side, you can see like we all are pulling sledges. Then there used to be classes in the night, like if you can see the center picture, it's night and temperature may be around minus 15 degree to minus 20 degree Celsius. But at the same time, you are surviving also and you are also trying to learn from the nature. So then on the right, this is the, have you heard of canyons, Grand Canyons? So there was one section of canyoneering for 27 days. Then again, it's like, so this was on the left side, if you see this, used to be our kitchen. Like we had to melt snow and make water out of it. And the kitchen was also made from by the platform made of the snow and ice. And canoeing on the left side and canyons on the right side. So after that, I went on to climb many peaks. I went to some peaks in Himachal and Uttarakhand. Then I went to Mount Aconcagua. I climbed it successfully. It's the highest peak outside Asia. It's in Argentina. And after that, I was ready to climb Mount Everest in 2015. And as sir mentioned, when we were when we were on camp on 25th of April, I can still remember it because that was the most scariest day of my life. So we were on Everest. We were at Camp 2. Camp 2 is at roughly 6,500 meters. And there, if you remember, there was an earthquake in Nepal where more than 9,000 people lost their lives in Kathmandu. So I was in Camp 2. So there is small video, and then I will. So this is the video of the base camp. Like this is how the base camp looks like. So you. This the whole this whole like mass of snow and ice. Okay, so this video was in base camp. So at that time we were in Camp 2. So Camp 2 is so Everest mein kya hota hai, like between base camp and summit there are four camps in between. And Camp 2 is surrounded by like Lhotse is another 8,000 meter peak, and on Everest face one side and Dhupse on one side. Lot of acclimatization to climb any 8,000 meter peak because oxygen pressure is so low that if I take all of you and put you on the summit of Everest by aeroplane and then we all will die in a minute because our body is not adapted to low oxygen pressure. So for that your body has to be acclimatized and well adapted, then only you can climb 8,000 meter peak, and it takes time. So when acclimatization takes place, your RBCs are getting developed in your body, so they can carry more oxygen, and so you are ready. So that's why 8,000 meter peaks take so much of time. People ask why it takes 1.5 months to 2 months just to climb 8,000 meter peak. So what happens is you are in the base camp, you go higher up to the mountain, like higher up to the one camp, and then you come down again to the base camp. So it basically climb high, sleep low. So you climb high, sleep low is very important phenomena in the mountaineering. And when you are in the base camp, so it's like this. You are in the base camp. Base camp is 5,000 meters roughly, 5,500 meters. You go till 6,000 meters, then you again come back to base camp. Then you stay 2 nights to 3 nights in base camp. Then next time you go to camp 1, camp 2, and then you again come back to base camp. So you feel like when you are in the base camp, staying in the base camp, you think you are not progressing. Like you are still at the same altitude. But at, like you are not progressing in terms of the altitude, but we are progressing in terms of the our own body capability. And that will help us in the final summit push. And in the final summit, and once we reach camp 3 is 7,300 meters, you are ready for the final summit push. So for the final acclimatization rotation, you go till camp 3 and come back again to the base camp. And then finally you start from base camp and you have to go to the summit and come back. And after camp 3, we put supplementary oxygen because oxygen pressure is so low. Climbing without supplementary oxygen is very difficult. But it's not impossible. There are few people in the world who have climbed Everest without supplementary oxygen. Reinhold Messner was the first person in the world who climbed it. So if there have been around 5,000 summits of the Everest in the history of whole humanity, you can say, out of 5,200 summits have been without oxygen. And there are very few Indians who have done it. There was one team from Indian Army, 2 or 3 people have submitted without oxygen last year. So this is how the, so like I was sharing the, so we on 25th of April 2015, we were in camp 2. And so we were doing our rotation, jaisa main bata raha tha ki base camp se camp 1, camp 2. So I just reached camp 2 and with me there was one Mexican climber and one Australian climber. So we were like, just after reaching camp, we have to hydrate. So we were drinking just like lap tea in the camp. And suddenly we felt like ground was shaking. So camp 2 is on the glacier, ek achanak se shake hua. And jaise hi wo shake hua, to we came out of the tent, hame laga ki kuch localized hoga. And second time, bahut tez se shake hua. And when you are in the glacier, sometimes it feels kaisa nahi ho ki it will wahi pad jaye and you will go inside it. Is tarah ka feeling aaya. And on that day, the weather was not very clear. So sometimes when weather is not good in the mountain, it's a complete whiteout. You can't see like more than beyond 15 meter or 20 meter. So jab hum jaise hi bahar nikle, so hum kuch dekh nahi pa rahe the, but we can hear the sound of avalanches coming from the Lhotse face. So there was an avalanche on the Lhotse face, and then there was an avalanche on the right side, and there was one Mexican climber with me who said if there is avalanche on this Everest face, we could be in danger. Jaise hi we see, look, hum udhar hi dekhte hain, within a second se ek avalanche wahan se niche aa raha hota hai, like huge mass of snow and rocks coming downwards. And for a moment my heartbeat stopped ki you can't run an avalanche. Avalanche ko aap dekh kahan hi bhag sakte ho. So us time pe ye laga ki what will be next. So itna jaldi hota hai ye sab cheeze, like within moments, within some seconds that avalanche came. But we were lucky that we were not in the direct fall zone and direct hamare upar uska impact nahi aaya. But uske baad jo hota hai na debris, jab avalanche aata hai to snow dust wagera ud ke aata hai. So we went inside the tent, wo sab hold karke rakha. And us time tak humne nahi samajh maara tha ki what's happening actually. So initially we thought it's something localized which has happened, and we informed base camp that we felt some avalanches but we all are safe. And at that time base camp mein nahi bataya tha ki similar thing has happened in the base camp. By the evening we got to know that there was a big earthquake in Nepal and there was an avalanche in base camp also, and people have lost their lives. And by the evening I realized the gravity of the situation, that it would be the big news all over the world. And people back home would also be in a like all your attention ho gaya hoga ghar pe and in the company and like especially the family. So us din, like on that evening I was not able to communicate, because when you are higher in the camps you can't communicate from the outside world, you can communicate only to the base camp. So we informed the base camp that everything is fine. And then the next day again in the morning I tried to communicate with them, but I was not able to do it. In the afternoon, I got one satellite phone from one of my mountaineering friends. So through that phone, I called my mother and I can talk to her only for like 30 seconds or 40 seconds, and she was crying on the phone. So I just told her that I am safe, everything is safe, and I will talk to you after 2 days when we are down. So after that, we were evacuated from camp one by helicopter. We came back to base camp, and there were so many deaths, so there was no point of climbing. Like, the expedition got cancelled, and all of us returned to the, like, so we all returned to the India. And so in 2015, again, it was a failure, and like, there was one thing left, ki when you come back, you are very disappointed, because you train for it, you practice for it for so many years, and finally, in the end, it's successful only if you are on the summit. So I came back, and first thing was like, there was the feeling that we all are safe, and mountain is always there, we can always go back, because Himalaya would be there for, it is there for millions of years, it will be there for millions of years. So that was the one thing, that our life is same, so we can always go back. So in 2015, so I thought I will go back in 2016, but there was some issues with my, like, I had to convince my mother again. So in 16, I was not allowed to go. In 2017, I again went back to Everest. And so now I will share the story of 2017. So this is basically the roadmap which I was. So, like, so to climb Everest, you have to go to Kathmandu. So there are two routes. One is through Nepal side, one is through Tibet side. So most of the people goes from Nepal side. So you go to Kathmandu, then you fly to Lukla, and Lukla is roughly 3,000 meters. Everest altitude to सबको पता है ना कितना है?
8848
meters. So our planes हमारे fly करते हैं, they fly at that altitude. Just to imagine. So oxygen pressure at Everest summit is 33% of the oxygen at the sea level. Like, the oxygen pressure here and at the summit, so it's only 33% what we have right now. So this is the route to the Everest. So this is camp 1, 6,100 meters. And camp 1 to camp 2. So that's the Lhotse face. If you see in front, Lhotse is another 8,000 meter peak, whose face is camp 2 is 6,300 meter. Camp 3 is 7,300 meters. And then camp 4 is 8,000 meter. And camp above camp 4, it's called death zone also. So it's called death zone because above 8,000 meter oxygen pressure is so low. How much fit you are, how much acclimatized you are. If you survive, if you stay more time here, your body is deteriorating, your cells are dying. So that's why it's called death zone. So what we have to do, we have to minimize our exposure into that altitude, in that atmosphere. So for the final summit push, what we do, we start from base camp. In one day, we go from base camp to camp 2. And between base camp and camp 2, there is Khumbu Icefall. Anyone have heard of Khumbu Icefall? Khumbu Icefall is here. Everest movie dekhi hai kisi ne? So Khumbu Icefall is basically base camp and camp 1 ke beech mein. So Khumbu Icefall is basically a moving glacier. So the glacier is moving, and what happens is, if you see the time lapse video of the icefall, you will see the ice blocks are moving over the period of time. So if you see it, you will see that ice block is stationary. But if you see a time lapse video, maybe you will find that ice blocks are moving. In maybe if you see the time lapse of 1 year, the whole thing is moving. So that ice block is very, that ice fall is very risky. There are big crevasses, and you have to. So you see this on the right side, there are crevasses. So sometimes crevasses are so deep, you have to cross the ladder. And you can't see the end of the crevasse. And if you fall, so there is always a safety, but even if you fall, it's not a, it can be a very tricky situation to come out of the crevasse. So we have to be very careful. And in the ice fall, sometimes you are climbing up and there is big ice fall looming over your head. So you, and for that moment, you want to try to cross it as fast as possible, because when the sun comes, the melting starts, there are chances maybe small avalanches can come from it. And in 2014, there was huge avalanche in the Kumbh Icefall itself, where 18 Sherpas lost their lives. So, what are the major challenges, as I have said, or like low oxygen pressure is one of the biggest challenge. And because of this, people have the feeling of headache and a high altitude sickness and just a shortness of breath. Like when we are in the mountains, the oxygen is so low, when we breathe in, we are taking a dry air. And when we are breathing out, we are giving moist air out in the environment. So because of it, dehydration is much more as compared to the sea level. And when we are at the same time, we are breathing very fast. Because oxygen level is very low, we are breathing in a very fast rate. So that's why dehydration also increases. And the cold temperatures at the summit or like between camp 4 to summit can go as low as minus 40 to minus 45 degrees Celsius. It also depends on the wind chill factor. Because of the winds, the temperature also reduces by a much larger amount. And for the final summit push, what we see from camp 4 to summit, the wind should be in the range of 30 to 50 kilometers per hour. Normally, jets are in the ranges of 100 to 150 kilometers per hour. And at that wind, you can't climb, because then there will be a chance of hypothermia or frostbite. Anyone knows what is frostbite? Frostbite is basically, it happens in extreme cold situation. When you are climbing, your extremes can hurt the body, your fingers, your toes, your ears and your nose, where blood circulation is not as fast because they are away from the heart. So there, if it's very cold and if you are not moving your hands, so there can be a chances of frostbite. So initially what happens is, you will start feeling numbness in your fingers or toes, and if you do not get enough warmth or enough blood circulation to your extremes, then they can start getting freezing. any point if I could have given up, like if I thought ki nahi ho payega, then wahi par expedition fail ho jata. So for that time, mentally you have to be very strong. Nahi, I have to do it. And at the same time, you also have to see that you are sometimes in a summit fever, people lose their lives also because they have so much of training, so many people are expecting from them, and they feel like if they can't submit, they will it would be a failure for them. So at that time, you have to take very wise decisions. You have to cut. Everyone wants to reach summit, but you can't lose your life just to reach the summit. So these is you can read so many case studies where people have lost their lives just going to the top, and they don't have any energy while they were coming down. So this is like I climbed Everest, but what's after climbing Everest? Like why people go to the mountains? It's not necessary you climb Everest or any mountain. It's just climbing Everest. There are so many mountains, but there are many learnings which I take personally and which I think people can relate it to directly, which are applicable to all of us, and it applies to our like our personal. right? And we are not thinking in terms of a humanity point of view. So these things, I think great things can be achieved when we work in a team. If we all work in individual silos, then it would be difficult to achieve. And third is, to achieve anything, we all have to get out of our comfort zone, and innovation comes directly if we take risk. If you have to innovate, you have to take some risk. And if there are adversities, there are some opportunities. And bolte na ki magic happens in outside your comfort zone. For me, my comfort zone was I could have been working in any of the but for me it was mere ko tha ki bahar nikalna hai, and I have to push myself. I have to prepare myself for the difficult thing, then I only we can achieve. And same thing I applied to us. If we do our jobs regularly, if we not try to innovate every day, not take risk, then maybe we all will be stuck at the same level. To jump forward, we have to slightly push ourselves, slightly push our peers, slightly push our teams. Then decision making in mountaineering, decision making is high stake decision making, like as I was mentioning, whether you have to continue or return back. So it can be a life or death situation. If any one of you have heard of a tragedy on Mount Everest in 1996, there is a famous case study also. So at that time, 8 people died on the Everest, and their fault was, so normally on the mountain there is a turnaround time. So we try to turn around by 12 p.m. in the afternoon. If we delay it further, so what happens is, afternoon, like after 1 p.m., if weather turns bad, there can be a chances of storm. So these people were climbing, and they have fixed a turnaround time of 12, but there were few people who were slow in going up, and instead of turning back, they continued, and the final person to reach the summit was at 4 p.m. So it was very late, and all of them got caught in the storm, and eight or nine of them were not able to come back to camp 4, and they had to lose their life. So it was one bad decision, by the leader and also by the member, and they had to lose their life. And sometimes you will think you have to go there, you have to succeed, but it's not necessary what you are thinking it will work. If plan A is not working, then you should be ready with the plan B. So in 2015, our plan was to submit, but at that time, second thing was our safety is more important. So plan B. So there should always be a plan B. And in workplace also, you will find you have to take decisions. And decision making can be either consultative decision. So as per the situation, you have to take decisions. I think you will learn more about decision making styles in some of your classes. So I'm not going into much more story of that. And then more important thing which I feel is like disconnect to connect. When we are away from the civilization, like when we are away from our regular phone calls, emails, because when we are here in the offices, we are normally distracted by so many things going around, and we are not able to reflect ourselves. So there is so limited time for the self-reflection. So there has been some research also where it has been observed that when people go away from the cities, maybe in the wilderness for 4 or 5 days, when they come back, their creativity increases, because there they are able to reflect on themselves, their peers are also with them, and in a small group, learning is much more, and when they come back, they have the new perspective to the life and to the work and what they want to do it. And have you heard of Netflix? Netflix CEO, he took his team for 5 days into the wilderness trip because productivity of the team was going down. After they came back, they realized that productivity has increased, and there were some new ideas within the team members. And last but not the least is, you always have to learn from the failures. I failed in my first expedition, which was Chamche Kang expedition in Leh. I failed again in Everest in 2015. But in each expedition, so we always say journey is more important than the destination. It's not necessary every time we reach the summit. So more things we learn when we are along the route. Because at the summit, you stay only for 10 to 15 minutes. Whole thing you learn is on the way. So in each expedition, even if I had failed, there were learnings which I thought would be helpful for me if I implement them. So every time whenever we go, and it happens to us in the plant also, you are working for some project, you can fail. But if you sit in a team and realize and try to find out what are the things which had resulted in the failure, then next time you are more prepared. So like you experience, you reflect, and then predict for the next time. And this cycle continues. Even if we are successful, we should sit down and see what are the things which went well. Even if it's the success, there are always the things which could have been done better. So we should always try to learn from the failures. And I think there is no person who have never failed in his life, who have been always successful. You can see any examples of the leaders throughout the world, you will find them, they all have failed somewhere in their lives. But the champion amongst them is the one who has learned from it and came out of it. So, like what you see in this picture, like if you see when you are climbing, you are balanced, like there is balance between you and the rock, your hands, you are at that time, so mind, state of mind has to be very calm. You can't panic. If you are panicking, then you will get tired very early and you will not be able to continue. So everything is under control. And when you are climbing, there is always a person who is giving you the belief. So you have to also trust him. So I think climbing is also the same, whether you are climbing or whatever is the life. Both correlates to each other. In the life also, we have to make balance with the physical, emotional and spiritual things. We have to make balance with the family, friends, your work time, your fitness, so there can be a very rich person but who is not very happy in the life. But there can be a CEO of the company, but he is suffering from, his family is not doing well. So if you make balance between all of the things, because even what I try to do it, because I have to maintain my fitness, I have to work also. So you have to give time to everything and make out a proper balance. And in the end, success is all about being happy. If you are happy in the life, we can say we are successful. It's not that how much money we have earned or how much. Like, there is no end to the corporate ladder also. Like every, you can grow, but in the end, so you have to make a proper balance out of it. So yes, that's it from my side, and maybe you can open for question and answers.
Thank you very much. I think let's have a little bit of a time, but I have a few questions to ask you. So if you come on, maybe we'll capture it much, much easier. One question that I had on behalf of the house was, when you're talking about high altitude climbing, at some point of time, it's a balance of both technical skills, these training and competence and all that drill goes into, and a battle of the mind. Now, what prevails, say, between 17,000 and 29,000 feet? What really comes to the place?
So, after some point of time, it's more of a mental fitness, because we can always work on our physical fitness and there is always a room for improvement. But at when we are at 25,000 feet, so oxygen pressure is so low and sometimes we feel disoriented, we are not able to think rationally. And at that time, your mental fitness comes into play. So when I used to go for the mountaineering, Pachindri mein hamesha bolti thi ki ek step le lo, then if you take one step, then take the next step. And ek step karke aap apne destination ke close pahunche ho. When you look at the summit, you will feel ki main to bahut dur abhi aa gaya. But agar main ek step lete ja raha hu, to dheere dheere main uske paas pahunch ja raha hu. So at that time, your focus is only to take small steps. And so, I think mental fitness is more important.
You have also been dealing with the outbound learning for corporates. Started off with core marketing. Mm-hmm. How do you transfer that learning to the corporate world?
So, as I was mentioning that when we go in a team, so like if we take a team of, let's say if we take a team of this class to the mountains. So, if it's a 5-day expedition, in each day there will be a different scenarios when people who are working in a team, they will face certain things which are not known to them, and how they react to it, versus how they react to it and how they work together to achieve their goal. So there is always a goal. Maybe it can be reaching a summit of 13,000 feet, or doing some activity. So, and when we are in the non-conventional setting, we are able to interact with each other in a much more informally, like when we are like in the office scenario, sometimes we are not able to read very freely. And these are the things which apply directly to our lives, which are applicable to the mountains.
Another small supplementary question, I mean, Everest is an expedition. We have not seen very few instances of individuals climbing it just like it's an expedition. So, how do you place the role of the team and the role of the leader in the success of an expedition like this?
So, if there is a team, so there has to be a leader, because team, it's not necessarily like, so there are four different roles of a leader, four leadership roles, like only designated leader. But if leader is saying something and if team members are not following it, leader can't do anything alone. So again, active followership is also a leadership style. So what leader is saying, what leader has taken a decision, then the team members have to follow it. Then self-leadership, like just if I say I'm climbing a mountain and we leave, amongst the team, it has been decided like we all have to be ready at 5 a.m. in the morning. If one member is not ready, he is sleeping in the tent itself. So because of him, whole team is suffering. So self-leadership is also a very important leadership style. And fourth one is peer leadership, which one is like helping each other. So role of a leader is very important, because he or she gives you the direction, the vision, and the whole team member has to go along with him or her. Because leader alone can't achieve anything, and team without goal, you can't go anywhere.
And how important is trust in a high stakes dimension like mountaineering, and what are the implications of this kind of thing in the corporate?
So trust is very important. Like when we are climbing up, we have to trust our team members. Like sometimes when we are climbing up, one person is giving us belay, and so he is holding the rope and we are climbing up. If this person makes a mistake, then I can be in a real danger. There can be a big accident. And in the corporate also, like if we are five members in a team and we are doing some task, so we have to trust each other that all of us will work with full hard work and honesty. And second, we have to trust, like, because we always divide the work in ourselves. So we have to trust other members, they also will be doing. Because if we keep interrupting, like what you are doing, have you been able to do it or not, then there may be a frustration in the team, there may be a negative environment in the team. So we have to trust our team members. I think then there would be a positive learning environment in the team.
I request you to just walk us through the lessons that you drew from your leadership lessons. Once again, for the main bit of the house, just if you can walk us through all the lessons once again. So we can kind of take away the essence of your talk.
So six things which I feel is very important, what we can learn from the ordinary. Stay organized, be prepared, prioritize. So in the mountaineering, like as I have mentioned, like when you are climbing up, you have to carry everything in your rucksack. So you have to prioritize what are the things you want to carry, what are the things you want to leave. You can't leave very important things, and you don't have the luxury to have to take multiple jackets. So you have to prioritize, and you have to be very meticulous in your planning, because the real expedition starts at the home itself. When we are climbing up, you have to plan what are the things you need, how much kgs of ration you will need, how much layers you will need, how many layers you will need. Because if you make mistake at the ground, then definitely you will suffer there. Either you have to come back, you can lose your life, there can be any accidents. And same thing applies to us in the corporates, because whatever the task we are doing, whatever the work we are doing, we have to follow the standard operating procedures, we have to follow the checklist. And at least in the normal life, we have the liberty to say sorry, we can always there, but at that place, there is no chance to say sorry also. Then, second is, so as I have mentioned, mountaineering is not an individual game. and nothing can be achieved when you are as an individual. And same way applies in the corporates also. You have to work in a team, and working in a team you can achieve very difficult goals also. And in the this type of scenario, like true color of the person comes out. You will realize what type of person he or she is. So you can't hide yourself behind a mask. Then to achieve anything in the life or to innovate, there has to be some risk taking ability. If you see, just to start a steel plant, there was a risk. That's and then because to start a new venture, there is always a risk. But you have to take that risk, and because of that risk taking ability, we can succeed. So we have to go out of the comfort zone. To and we say magic happens when we go out of our comfort zone. And if there are adversities, then there are opportunities also. If market is not doing well, if there are some things which are not going as per our way, if we do more, so there is an adversity. But if our team works together, then there can be an opportunity, and which can further lead to innovation. Fourth is high stakes decision making. So in there, you have to take decisions which can result in your life or death, and you have to take decisions as per the situation. Sometimes you take decisions as per the like you have to take this. Like if one of your team member is not doing. So you have to turn back. So close that deal. So decisions and in the life also sometimes you have to take decision whether to continue, and there are so many decision making styles, like consultative or you take decisions as per your experience. And the next is learning from failures, because in the first expedition which I went, I failed. In the second expedition I went, I failed again. But always there are learnings which we can capture from it and try to implement it in our next our experience. So there is one cycle, like you experience, you reflect, then you predict each time. So though all of us in the life fail, every day we fail, but if we can learn from it, next time we are better prepared to tackle the situation. So these were the key learnings which I feel are very important in our life.
Once again, thank you, Hemant. I think we just had a very good interaction, and I'm sure we have picked up a lot of interesting points. So thank you once again, and we look forward to interacting more once again with you.
And thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Any other questions? One final round of questions before we close.
It may sound stupid to you, but why can't we take liquid intake for hydrating ourselves? Because we are releasing moisture.
So that we take liquid intake. So
why can't we supplement ourselves with enough quantity of liquid to hydrate ourselves? Because you are saying now we are releasing moisture.
So that's why.
So we are
right. So you are right. So when we are there, our diet is more liquid and less solid diet. So like we take lot of soup, lot of.
Even that is not enough to compensate the dry air that we are.
So that's enough. So if we are not taking enough liquid, then there can be a chance of dehydration. So what I was mentioning, there are some challenges which can happen if I am not taking proper measures. So it's not necessary everyone will go through dehydration, but if we take proper, so chances of dehydration are very high at that altitude as compared to sea level. So, because after 5000 meter, your body is also not able to eat properly. Your digestive system is not working properly. So, at altitude, you can't eat much. So at that time, your fat reserve in your body, and also you drink a lot of soup just to get going.
Sherpas who are guiding the mountaineers, as they go up the summit.
Yes, Sherpa also. So, one Sherpa go with the one climber. So there are Sherpas who have climbed Everest multiple times, well, like 5 times, 6 times.
The flag, the mountaineers first start the summit, but then let it see for temporary turn after 15 minutes that they stay there or they press it permanently.
No, they take it and they bring it back. If so many people put the flag on the Everest, then it would be take garbage or flags on the summit.
How it looks like sitting on the top of the summit, I mean, with the environment dikhta agar aap uske top pe rehte hain.
You will see, like, so you are on the top of the highest point of the planet, you can say. So everything is like below you, and so it's basically, so Everest of, so it's surrounded by Nepal. One side is Nepal, one side is Tibet. So you will see, once the mountains, you want to see smaller mountains and whole white, like pura whitey white. So the feeling was like you are at the top, like you can see everything below you.
You mentioned that during the first expedition, you survived your life, narrowly escaped. So what was that motivated you to climb the second time? It's very difficult because you have experienced life threat from so near. What is that thing that motivated you to again climb it?
So after I came back, we were trapped in the earthquake. So, if you see, earthquake doesn't happen very regularly. So, earthquake happened after 70 or 80 odd years, and we were very lucky. We were unlucky at that time we were climbing the mountain, and so that was the first feeling. And second was that if we do our more training, maybe, so earthquake is one of the eventuality, but we are more prepared for another unknown situations. And third is like, अर्थक्वेक वगैरह आना है तो इफ यू आर सिटिंग इन जमशेदपुर या कहीं भी वो आ सकता है तो थोड़ा सा रिस्क है एंड माउंटेनियरिंग में देयर इज ऑलवेज अ रिस्क सो यू हैव टू टेक अ कैलकुलेटेड रिस्क एंड देन यू कंटिन्यू थोड़ा रिस्क रहता है उसमें बट एक वो मोटिवेशन रहता है कि यू प्रे कि नहीं होगा वो थोड़ा सा बट इफ समथिंग बैड हैज टू हैपन इट कैन हैपन इन द इवन वी आर देयर तो वो फीलिंग के साथ यू गो बैक अगेन.
How many people can stand on the summit? That
10 to 12 people, 10 to 15 people.
10 to 15.
Yeah.
It's very small.
It's not very small, 15-20 are number. So there are few peaks where only one people, so it's like point and peak where only one person can stand. But on average, there are 15-20 people who can, around 15 can stand.
How many people take an attempt to mount the summit?
So if you see, the history. So Everest was first climbed in 1953. Till 1990s, there were very few people who climbed Everest. After 1990 or after 2000, the commercialization of Everest started. But it's the highest peak of the world, so there is always the attraction. So now more and more people are going into mountaineering and adventure, even in India. So earlier there were very few Indians who used to climb. But if you see the data for past 3-4 years, many Indians have climbed Everest.
No, I'm asking from the base to summit.
Yeah. So in a year, around 400 people try to climb Everest in a year. Yeah, 400 to 500. So 400 to 500. If you see the past 4-5 years data, if you could see before 2000, then it may be like hardly 50-60 people in a year who were trying.
Is that speciality about Hillary step?
So Hillary step बोलते हैं कि after earthquake Hillary step थोड़ा modify हो गया था because there was one overhanging rock which broke. So Hillary step is not as actual which was like 5 years back.
Initially it was difficult to climb.
Initially it was little more difficult to climb than right now. So मैंने तो एक ही बार देखा है तो मैं compare नहीं कर सकता. But the people seen it twice, or there were photos on the internet also. So there was one overhanging rock which has been removed now from the terrace. So oh, it has become a little easy.
कैसे feelings तो जब आप पहला वो step रखा मतलब target achieve हो गया जब
feeling जो like on the summit तो frankly sometimes your mind goes blank also. First feeling तो मैंने बोला था कि feeling of gratitude, like you want to say like my flashback में वो memories आती है, you are preparing for it for so long. So there were people behind you, like mere ghar pe meri family and opportunity ma'am, the people in the company, your friends. So sabko you say thanks to the mountain god also who allowed you to reach the top. And then second feeling ye rehta hai ki abhi expedition khatam nahi hua, you have to go back safely. Kyunki sabse zyada chances niche utarte waqt hote hain, safely niche utar usme to summit pe you can't enjoy much. So this time wahi rehta hai mind mein, when you reach base camp then feeling starts to get sinking. You have finally returned back to base camp safely, now you are safe.
How do you cope up with individual decision making and team decision making? Like you said, a team of 8 people lost their lives. So there are different situations while climbing from base camp to the top of the summit. If some of the team members are so inclined to achieve the goal, while others consider safety, how to take decision at that point of time?
So
as a team.
So as a team at that time, if there is a leader in the team, so he or she has to take the decision whether to turn around, looking at the situation. So that's why, so there can be a situation when there in a team there are 2-3 ambitious people who really want to do it, and there are 4 or 5 people who want to go back. So it could have. So at that time, they have to take decision. And if they continue and something bad happens, then it's the bad decision. And if they would have returned safely and came back again, so. In the team, either you take concentrated decision making, like you consult with the group, or the leader with his own experience take the direct decision, like we are returning back. So in the army, ek baar leader ne jo decision le liya, you have to follow it, no questions asked. But in such type of group, sometimes people may start asking, or time pe leader sahi se decision nahi le paya, so it can be. Not necessary. Even in the office, maybe there is a hard discussion about it. There are always people who are silent. Who are willing to give over our
single. So, there's a point like a good team bonding at the base camp rather than having some deliberations.
So, base camp is at the time, I think it's a team bonding. And there are always people in the base camp who will go against the team. And, kai expeditions, paisa hua hai ki. टीम का डिसीजन लेके नीचे जाना है, हो सकता है वेदर ठीक था, समिट भी हो जाता, बट टीम डिसीजन का नीचे आना है, तो सब लोग आगे दे वाला है अबाउट इट. तो डिसीजंस क्या होते हैं, जरूरी नहीं है डिसीजंस ले लेते हैं, दे कैन बी राइट, दे कैन बी रॉन्ग, और डिसीजन मेकिंग का कोई फॉर्मूला भी नहीं. आई थिंक लाइफ में भी ऐसा होता है ना कि कई बार इंडिविजुअल लेवल पे हम कैसे डिसीजन लेते हैं, कई बार वो सही हो जाते हैं, कई बार गलत हो जाते हैं. बट यू हैव टू, जो भी आपने लिया है, वी शुड बी लाइक प्राउड अबाउट इट, वो जो भी डिसीजन है उसको बाद में रिग्रेट नहीं करते रहना चाहिए, उस टाइम ये कर देता तो अच्छा रहता, वो करेगा अच्छा रहता, जो भी हवा है वो डायनेमिक सिचुएशन
है. इन योर एज ब्रैकेट हाउ मेनी हैव अचीव्ड दिस स्टार?
इन माय एज ब्रैकेट डिफिकल्ट होगा, बट ओवरऑल एवरेस्ट समिट अराउंड, अगर टोटल समिट्स जो नॉर्मल शेरपास को हटा दे, तो 3,000 लोगों ने समिट किया होगा एवरेस्ट इन द हिस्ट्री ऑफ माउंटेनिंग. 3,000 लोगों ने हो क्या है, मतलब एक बार देखता हूँ की मैं आई सी द इमेज, मतलब आई सी 8,400 मीटर्स पे देख रहा हूँ की धुआं टाइप निकल रहा है, आई सी वन इमेजिनरी फिगर सिटिंग ओवर, मतलब एक बंदा बैठा हुआ है वहां पर, यू सी वन पर्सन सिटिंग ऑन दैट, एंड देन योर लॉजिकल थिंकिंग बोलती है कि इस एल्टीट्यूड पर तो कोई बैठ ही नहीं सकता, एंड 2-3 मिनट आप थोड़ा आंखों को फोकस करने का ट्राई करते हो, एंड एक तो यहाँ पे कोई नहीं है, एंड देन आई एम क्लाइंबिंग, और मेरे को समझ नहीं आ रहा है कि चल क्या रहा है, ऐसा लग रहा है कि मैं रोड पे वॉक कर रहा हूँ. वो उस टाइम पे लाइक इतना डिसोरिएंटेड था, उस टाइम पर एक समझ आ रहा है कि क्या रहा है, उस टाइम पर मे बी आई वुड हैव गिवन अप कि नहीं अब वापस चलते हैं, बट मेरे अंदर ऐसा भी नहीं था कि मैं बिल्कुल ही डिसओरिएंटेड हूँ. वर्स्ट सिचुएशन ये होती कि मेरे को पूरे टाइम में कुछ समझ नहीं आ रहा है, सो इट वाज हैपनिंग इन पेजेस लाइक फॉर 2-3 मिनट्स इन हाफ एन आवर वाला, तो वो एक डिफिकल्ट था. एंड देन 2015 एक्सपीरियंस वाज वेरी डिफिकल्ट, एंड स्पेशली आफ्टर कमिंग बैक द होल सिचुएशन इन द फैमिली, एंड जब वापस से कन्विंस करना अगेन कि फिर से आना, वो यार डिफिकल्ट था एज कम्पेयर टू एक्चुअल क्लाइंबिंग इन सेल्फ.
Is it true the path of the Mount Everest has been polluted because of so many climbers are trying to reach there, or is to bring back all the stuff, food stuffs and wrappers of that, to bring back down to the camp area?
It's true that so many people are going on the Everest and it has polluted it in some way. But in past 4-5 years, there has been some awareness on keeping the Everest clean, and there have been many activists around the world who are pushing to keep it clean. So now there have been strict regulations to bring your waste back to the back to the base camp, but again further down to the villages where it can be further processed or recycled. But still, the rules and regulations are not enforced. Like it's Nepal government is taking it, so it's same as Indian government. The rules are there, but strictly followed. So there are again there are so many agencies who are working. There are agencies who are ethically. They want to protect the mountain, so they bring all of their supplies back. And there are few companies who leave some of their stuff on the mountain. So definitely, if so many people go to the mountain, then it's affecting the environment over there.
Is there any कुछ माउंटेनियर्स गए हैं जिनकी बॉडी अभी तक रिकवर नहीं हुई सबकी होगी अनफॉर्चुनेटली जो
देयर आर मोर देन 100 बॉडीज स्टिल ऑन द एवरेस्ट And when I was climbing, when I was coming down myself, I saw two dead bodies on the way. Because अगर वहाँ पर death camp to के ऊपर death हो जाती है तो rescue करना या body लाना भी बहुत मुश्किल है क्योंकि आप body को उठा के नहीं ला सकते to just bring down the body back is itself an expedition itself. 2016 में there were few people from three Kolkata. Person died on the Everest. Next year, उनको लिए West Bengal government ने team भेजा था just to bring down the body. तो body लाना काफी expensive भी होता है and resources उतने नहीं होते हैं and कई बार body खराब situation होती है. So it's the decision of the family if they want to bring the body back. But काफी bodies अभी भी Everest पर हैं. Everest and ऐसे जो 8000 meter peak से उसपे काफी bodies. कई बार bodies मतलब crevasse में चले जाती है. It has accidents होते हैं मतलब पर हाइपोथर्मिया होता है तो डिसोरिएंटेशन ज्यादा हो जाता है हाई एल्टीट्यूड सिकनेस ए पेक होता है जिसमें लोग अपने कपड़े खोलने लगते हैं डैट मतलब इतनी ज्यादा ठंड है और उनको हाई एल्टीट्यूड पल्मोनरी सेरेब्रल ऑडिमा हो जाता है तो उसमें रैशेस एक ही काम नहीं करती है और उनको अंदर से ऐसा लगता है पसीने आ रहे हैं एंड सब कुछ रिमूव कर देता है सारी लेयर्स फिर उसके बाद 4-5-15-20 मिनट की डेथ हो जाती है तो एक दो केसेस ऐसे भी हुए एक दो केसेस हुए जिसमें मतलब स्टीप स्लोप था और They fell into the valley. So, which unfortunate incidents होते हैं every year. Some people die on Everest.
Training के time पे कभी आपको कभी लगा why I'm doing this? नहीं करना चाहिए था.
काफी बार लगता है जब mountains पे रहते हैं कि क्यों कर रहा हूँ मैं. अभी भी लगता है. क्योंकि when you are there, so when like you are passing going through a very difficult day, and उस time पे लगता है कि यार जमशेदपुर में बैठे होते तो अच्छा रहता. But once you come back. And once you reach the summit or once you are able to do it successfully, once you are sleep, just एक बार खत्म करने के बाद you feel कि कर तो लिया है मैंने. And वही जो thinking वो mind में रहती है कि मतलब फिर push करने में अपने को खुद को मजा आने लगता है. You start enjoying the process of pushing yourself.
Are you planning to climb it again?
Not Everest, but another 8000 meters, maybe Kanchenjunga or different peaks.
So Everest के बाद अब next क्या?
So Everest is the highest peak in the world, but it's not the most difficult peak. K2, Indians are not allowed to climb K2, but Kanchenjunga is difficult than Everest, and there are other peaks. Even there are peaks like 600 meter high, which are more difficult than Everest because of technicality. So I have some targets in my mind, and then apart from this, I like doing long distance running. So I have done full marathon. My plan is to do ultra marathon, like more than 50 kilometer runs. So you have to do it. There are runs you have 100 kilometer run. You have to do it 15 hours, 16 hours. So the ultra running का भी मेरा target है.
How much time it will take from base camp 4 to Everest?
From camp 4.
Base camp 4.
From camp 4 to summit, if normally it takes between 6 to 9 hours. 6 to 9 hours. So I started from camp 4 at 9 in the night, and I was at summit at 6:15. कितना ऑक्सीजन है तुम्हारे पास तो वो बचेगा या नहीं बचेगा
डिसीजन मतलब ग्रुप में ऐसे उसमें लेना पड़ा कि ये करना है या नहीं करना है
अभी 2017 में मेरे साथ देयर वाज कली विद मी देयर वाज वन मोर कलीग ऑफ टाटा स्टील पायो मुर्मू शी इज 53 इयर्स ओल्ड because he was also climbing Everest with me. So we both were supported by Tata Shri, sponsored by Tata Shri. He is 53 years old. 52 or 53. So camp 3 se jab camp 4 jaate na, so camp 4 pahunchte hain same evening you have to start for the summit. So while coming from camp 3 to camp 4, normally people reach by 1 pm, 2 pm in the afternoon. जिससे 4-5 घंटे का थोड़ा रेस्ट मिल जाए, रात में यू कैन स्टार्ट अगेन फॉर द फाइनल समिट. सो शी गॉट लेट व्हाइल रीचिंग कैंप 4. सो शी रीच कैंप 4 एट 6:30 इन द इवनिंग एंड एट दैट टाइम शेरपा टोल्ड हर यू कांट गो एनी फर्दर, यू हैव टू गो बैक. एंड दैट डिसीजन फॉर हर इट वॉज लाइक कोई भी हो वहाँ पर कि इतना ऊपर तक पहुँच गए अगर आपको बोल दिया जाएगा कि अब आपको आगे नहीं जाने देंगे तो काफ़ी ज़्यादा वो होता है लाइक शी वॉज वेरी डिसअपॉइंटेड. नहीं बोलते आई विल कंटिन्यू, बट वो लोग शेरपा लोग क्या करते हैं, दे डू द कैलकुलेशन कैंप 3 से 4 में आपको इतना टाइम लगा है तो इतना ऑक्सीजन वाटर है तो आप 4 से समिट में कितना टाइम लगेगा एंड यू हैव टू रिटर्न बैक सेफली ऑल्सो. ऐसा नहीं हो कि आपका ऑक्सीजन खत्म हो जाए और आप रास्ते में रह जाओ. तो उन्होंने बोला कि नहीं आपको अलाउ नहीं करेंगे. एंड देन शी वाज कॉलिंग बेस कैंप, एक वॉकी टॉकी रहता कि नहीं मेरे को अलाउ करो. देन शेरपा ने बोला कि आप अगर आप इतने बोल रहे तो चलना है तो चलिए, नहीं तो ऑक्सीजन खत्म हो गया तो मैं छोड़ के आ जाऊँगा. मतलब एक हार्श डायलॉग ऐसा, शेरपा जनरली दे डोंट लीव यू, बट एक हार्ड डायलॉग उनको यूज करना पड़ा. एंड आई वॉज विद, आई वॉज ऑल्सो विद हर एट द सेम टाइम. तो एट दैट टाइम वी हैड टू टेक डिसीजन. तो वही हमने आपस में डिस्कस किया कि ठीक है सबमिट नहीं होगा बट यू हैव किड्स बैक होम, अगर ऊपर जाते हुए कुछ भी ट्रेजेडी हो गई तो लाइक कुछ भी हो सकता था. तो उन्होंने भी रियलाइज किया एंड शी हैड टू कम बैक फ्रॉम कैंप 4. अगर वो कंटिन्यू करती तो हो सकता है उनका सबमिट हो जाता. सबमिट हो जाता तो बोलते कि बहुत अच्छा डिसीजन था. समिट नहीं होता, कुछ ट्रेजेडी हो जाती, मे बी ऑक्सीजन खत्म हो जाता या कुछ भी हो सकता है, मतलब वर्स्ट केस में फर्टिलिटी हो जाती. देन वही एक चीज लाइफ, मतलब फिर तो अगर लाइफ ही नहीं है तो फिर सब कुछ खत्म. तो वो डिसीजन एक बहुत ही बड़ा डिसीजन था हम लोगों के लिए. तो बट उन लोगों उन्होंने डिसीजन लिया. तो शी कुड नॉट एबल टू मेक इट टू द समिट बट स्टिल इन हर एज शी इज द लाइक वन ऑफ द ओल्डेस्ट इंडियन क्यूज एल्टीट्यूड.
Thank you very much.